It's 2 p.m., so it's time to begin with the topic for today's presentation, which is going to be Louis Armstrong's West End Blues. And I was wondering if any of you fulfilled my homework assignment to go listen to it. Well, that's okay, because we will be playing it soon. We'll be playing it very soon. Don't worry. Towards the end of what I have to say, we'll actually put the piece of music on and just say a couple concluding words, because I think after I introduce it a bit, West End Blues will pretty much speak for itself. But I think it does need some introduction. So I thought among the many ways one could introduce this great piece of music is to talk about the greater tradition, not just the New Orleans jazz and blues tradition, which was essential to the actual music, that it came from in the broader 19th century scene. So by the time Buddy Bolden was beginning to make a name for himself in uptown New Orleans and around Storyville, and about the same time King Oliver was beginning to play on the trumpet, and we'll meet him again in a little bit, everywhere in the United States and the world, audiences were thrilling to the performances of the great virtuosi. And these were great solo musical artists who were able to fill stage after stage, recording hall, and theater after theater with their own monumentally talented presence. And they were individuals astonishingly good at the instruments they played. So in the 18th century, sometimes you'd hear these virtuosi play. But the 19th century, when travel was a lot easier, that's when they really came into their own. And we all probably have some examples in mind of great virtuosos, to give the other plural form of the word. But one of them that always springs to mind is the great Paganini. And he's going to be our first slide. Paganini should be coming up. There he is. That's Paganini, the first of the great virtuosos, also known as the devil's violinist, because it was said that the only way he could play so well was he had to have made a pact with the devil. And in fact, there was one performance where an audience member could swear she saw the devil right behind Paganini telling him how to play. So that's how good he was. He was so good that long before the Beatles, he was often mobbed in the streets by fans who just wanted a glimpse of him, and maybe if they were lucky, maybe a touch of him. And when he played, he always played without sheet music, which is very rare at the time. Normally there'd be a standard sheet music that a solo artist could at least refer to if they needed to. But Paganini would have nothing of sheet music on stage. He liked to roam around, and that meant that he wouldn't have a music stand anywhere near him. Maybe that's part of what made him so unusual and so popular. He made all sorts of money at the beginning of the 19th century into the 1830s and 1840s playing the violin in front of sold out audiences, but he gambled a great deal of it away. So by the time he died, there wasn't much left at all in his estate. But we know that he must have been really, really good because we know the compositions he left behind. And any of you who played violin, you might have run into the caprices of Paganini. They're pretty much impossible to play, especially number 24, which is the last of the caprices, or capricci. Caprices, probably. Now, some people speculate what made Paganini so good. And one of the theories is he may have had a condition known as Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, which makes your joints hyperextensive or sometimes hypermobile. And it was said that he could take a saucer, a little porcelain saucer in his hand, and just using his thumb and forefinger, break the saucer. And that's apparently what kind of joints he must have had in the hand. But he did ultimately pass away in the early 1840s. And the church, at first, refused to bury him in hallowed ground because, remember, he was said to have made a pact with the devil. But eventually he was buried in hallowed ground. And there was also, our next slide, an even more famous virtuoso, still played all the time, and that, of course, is Franz Liszt. And what he did for the piano was what Paganini had done for the violin. He would perform all by himself on stage, and he actually gave us the term recital in common use for somebody who's performing largely as a solo artist exhibiting his or her own talents. Listomania was the term given to the national and international fascination with Liszt. He played to huge enthusiastic crowds wherever he played, and women in the audience were said to compete with each other for just a touch of a handkerchief that he might actually have discarded on stage, a little version of Tom Jones mania right there in the 19th century with Franz Liszt. And he did cause women to faint. Doctors thought he must have some magnetic powers, so many women were fainting. But nevertheless, it's pretty clear that the secret to his appeal was his extraordinary talent, maybe the greatest piano player who ever lived. There's a lot of debate about that, but Liszt is always in the discussion. But one reason that crowds really loved him was not only that he was such a great piano player, but also he was so generous and good. a lot like Jenny Lind, who we met a few weeks ago. He gave most of his money that he made playing the piano to charity. And in fact, he never charged for lessons. If you were a piano player, you wanted to get better, and you were able to get some time with him, he wouldn't charge you. He thought that was his duty as a great piano player to pass on some of what he knew. Another thing about Liszt that I think is interesting, I got maybe two more interesting things about him. He was said to have been the first on stage to have the piano arranged so that his profile was to the audience rather than the piano here and the player behind. I've never actually been able to confirm that that's true, but I've often read that. And the other thing about Liszt was he had a cat named Madame Esmeralda, which I think is also very important. And now we go to the next slide. So now we have Paganini, we have Liszt, great examples of virtuosi or virtuosos. Another example with was Fritz Kreisler. That's not him, but he's a good example anyway. The much beloved Fritz Kreisler, who always told people that the reason he was inspired to play the violin in the late 19th century, when he really got his start, was that his father was friends with Sigmund Freud, and Freud used to come over and play the violin, and Kreisler was so impressed and inspired by that that he got a little matchbox and he put some little strings to it. He began kind of wiping away at that, and that's how he grew to play the violin. The only problem with that story is there's no reason to believe that Sigmund Freud ever played the violin. And this is what I think, even if he did play the violin, why would you be inspired by Sigmund Freud playing the violin? The story never made any sense to me, but that's what Kreisler always said. So Kreisler eventually became extremely popular in America. He's toured everywhere in America. He had to give it up during World War I because, after all, he was of Central European ancestry and was known to sympathize with the German side in World War I. So he laid low for a little while. But then he came back and he gave us a very popular musical called Apple Blossom Time. And does anybody know what great artist was premiered to American audiences in Apple Blossom Time on Broadway? Going once, going twice, and that was Fred Astaire. And Fred Kreisler's music was danced to by Fred Astaire for the first time on Broadway. And there was also Jascha Heifetz, the famous Jascha Heifetz, Ignacy Paderewski, future Prime Minister of Poland, was another great virtuoso who had packed them in. And then finally this guy. Here in America, an artist, maybe not of the stature of Kreisler or Paganini or Paderewski, but this is Herbert Clark. And I bring him up because now we're getting closer to home to Louis Armstrong and also to us, because Herbert Clark was born and raised in Woburn, Massachusetts, just down the road. And he eventually made a great name for himself as principal cornetist for the Sousa Band. So that's Herbert Clark there. Now he played the cornet, and that's a pretty good view of the cornet, kind of a more compact version of the modern trumpet. And when he was playing in the late 19th, early 20th century, most outstanding artists on a brass instrument like that would have been playing the cornet and not the trumpet. That was really far more common and more popular, especially in major bands, than the trumpet was. But Clark did something a bit unusual. He wasn't just a great player, but what he liked to do when he was going to play a solo for the Sousa Band, he'd often have his own compositions. He liked to start with maybe just a few measures where he'd improvise a little bit and show off his technique before he actually got to the main melody with a few variations here and there. And that was the cadenza. Cadenza is usually how you end a piece like this, but Clark liked to start pieces with these cadenzas. And I thought what I'd do, if it works, because I think this has a lot to do with Armstrong eventually, is play you a Herbert Clark cadenza. And I'm going to use this computer here just because I thought it would be easier, but I'm not really sure it's going to work. We'll have to see. In the meantime, you can feast your eyes on Herbert Clark. I think you're the only audiences in America now fixing your eyes on Herbert Clark, so you might as well. So this is a Herbert Clark cadenza, and I'll hold it up here so you can read it. This is a composition of his called Stars in a Velvety Sky. Pretty good.
Yeah. You don't blame him for trying to show off.
Yeah. And then he goes into the melody. So that wasn't Herbert Clark playing, that was a modern player. But that you get the idea of improvised showing off, kind of introductory in this case, to the main melody. He was famous for these cadenzas, and as we'll see, Louis Armstrong would take that idea and run with it. To maybe the most famous cadenza of all time, which we're about to see in West End Blues. But it's worth pointing out a couple things about Herbert Clark. He was not only a great player with the Sousa Band and sometimes on his own, he was also a great teacher. And he produced trumpet practice books that a lot of you, if you play trumpet, have probably played. They're still published today, and probably the most highly regarded of all trumpet compositional practice books that you can play as soon as you begin to be good at the instrument. And the other thing about him was he hated jazz. So ironically, because he would influence Louis Armstrong a lot, Clark was used to saying to anybody who listened to him that jazz was the nearest thing you could get to hell musically. So he had his blind spots in some matters, but at least he was influential, as again we'll see in a little bit. Now, when Clark was at the height of his fame, here we're in the second decade of the 20th century, and Kreisler and Heifetz were wowing elite audiences all across America, a little kid named Louis Armstrong was growing up around around Perdido Street in New Orleans, in what they used to call Black Storyville back then, in a very small shack with his sister and mother. Now we can go to the next slide. So to earn spare change, which was always sorely needed by his family, his mother had various jobs. Sometimes she'd get a little work as a prostitute, as a matter of fact. But she and the family were always in need of money. And Armstrong, even as a little kid, would try to work to just bring any bit of change he could into the household. But one thing that he used to do was he would wander the streets just as a little kid, 6, 7, 8 years old, with some other kids, and they'd sing for spare change for whoever was passing by who might want to give them something. And he took, after a little while, to playing a little 10-cent tin horn, and he tried to improvise melodies based upon the peddlers who go up and down the street singing old blues melodies to try to sell their products. So from a very early age, he was singing and he was playing whatever instrument he could get his hands on. And when he was 7 years old, he got to know a Lithuanian family, a family of Lithuanian Jews named the Karnofskys, and they would hire him for little odd jobs. Armstrong would sit in the back of a wagon, and the Karnofskys would take the wagon in and out of Storyville and other parts of New Orleans and sell coal, sometimes to the brothels, but to whoever was going to buy the coal. And Armstrong never forgot the Karnofskys for giving him that chance, giving him some money to perform this work when he really needed it. Other people in New Orleans did not like Jews, but Armstrong really took a shine to the Karnofskys and appreciated their generosity, and especially appreciated their determination, their habits of hard work, and their refusal to let surrounding anti-Semitism get them down. They just kept plugging away, and whatever they needed to do in their community, they would do to help each other out. And he never forgot that. And he so never forgot that as many of you know, if you've studied Louis Armstrong or read the fantastic Terry Teachout biography of Louis Armstrong, for much of the rest of his life, Louis Armstrong would wear a Star of David around his neck to remind him of the generosity of the Karnofskys. And he always had a little bit of matzah around the house that he would nibble on late at night. But his favorite food was always red beans and rice. Red beans and rice for Louis Armstrong was the secret of long life. He loved red beans and rice, being a true New Orleans guy. And in fact, his fourth wife, Louis Armstrong decided to marry her only after he figured out that she could actually cook red beans and rice. It was the only thing he was concerned about, but he eventually married her. Now, at this point, he was called Little Louis, wandering around doing what he could to earn money on the streets of New Orleans. He was too young to get into the clubs, but he would wait outside the clubs late at night, and he would hear Buddy Bolden, and he would hear King Oliver, who used to play at a place in Storyville called Pete's Lala's Cafe. So often at night, as late as he could, that's where Armstrong would be, listening through the window to King Oliver. But the great turning point in his life came when he was, I think, 12 years old, on the last day of 1912, when Louis Armstrong, it being New Year's Eve, decided to go out with his friends and have a little fun. And he reached into a cedar chest at the shack where he and his mother and his sister lived, and he pulled out a .38 caliber pistol. And the pistol was owned by somebody, a man who was sort of the boyfriend of Louis Armstrong's mother for a while, and he was keeping his gun there in the chest. So Armstrong loaded the .38 caliber pistol with blanks. He's not going to shoot anybody, he's just got blanks in the gun. And he began walking with his friends through New Orleans, and they got up to the corner of Rampart and Perdido, right by the Eagle Saloon, and everybody's having fun, kind of rabble-rousing because it's New Year's Eve. And a bunch of other kids walked up to them, and one of them were kind of shelling insults or something at them. And just to have a little bit of fun, Louis Armstrong took the .38 pistol that had blanks and began shooting it in the air. Wasn't even aiming it. But of course, that made a big noise, and the local police took some interest in this, that there was a 12-year-old kid with a 38 caliber pistol. So they arrested him for that, and they might have sent him home, but they didn't send him home. They took him to juvenile court, and the judge at the juvenile court didn't just let him off with a warning, as the judge might have done. Instead, the judge committed him to the local New Orleans, what they used to call the Home for Colored Waifs. And here you see Armstrong with the band at the Home for Colored Waifs in New Orleans. And this is him up here. You can see the arrow. That's young Louis Armstrong. And he always said later in life that this is one of the luckiest things that ever happened to him, that he was sent to that place. Because while he was there, there happened to be a teacher, a music teacher named Peter Davis, who took an interest in him and began to give him official lessons on the cornet. The Karnofskys had actually loaned Louis Armstrong $5 for his first cornet. So he'd actually been playing a little bit, but he really hadn't any lessons until he got there. And I like to point out that the very first song that Davis taught Louis Armstrong was, guess what, Home Sweet Home on the cornet. So soon, Armstrong was pretty good at this. He started out with this raw, incredible, almost otherworldly natural talent, but now he was beginning to hone it in these lessons, and Davis naturally let him join the band, and there he is, and he learned to play these slow, solemn tunes on the way to a funeral, and then step it up a bit in the second line on the way back. And along the way at the home, he seems to have been playing out of Herbert Clark's composition book, which had been published by now and was very popular. And he always said his life would have been completely different in completely unimaginable ways if he hadn't been arrested that night on New Year's Eve in New Orleans. But he eventually got out of the home, and he eventually went back to try to support his mother and his sister any way he could. And they had to do all sorts of things to survive. One of the things they would do when he was just barely middle school age was they would go to restaurants, and they would find food that had been discarded by the restaurant. And they would take the food home, and they would kind of cut away the rotten or the spoiled parts, and they take what remained, and they would try to resell it to other restaurants. And that's just the kind of thing you have to do to survive in the New Orleans of the time, especially in the kind of circumstances they were living in. But they did their best, and eventually Louis Armstrong was playing on an amateur basis anywhere he could, 14, 15, 16 years old. But meanwhile, now we go to the next slide, in a whole different part of New Orleans, there was a different world. Wow. Now, that's the famous West End of New Orleans. And one of the things about the West End is you could get really good seafood there. And that's one of the seafood restaurants that everybody patronized in New Orleans if they could. And that's Fitzgerald's. And you could get there from anywhere in New Orleans with a 15-cent round-trip streetcar ticket. And you could enjoy Fitzgerald's. You could enjoy the Ferris wheel. You could go through the Tunnel of Love because it was an amusement park too. You could enjoy the breezes coming off the lake, and you could experience the roller coaster, anything you wanted, as long as you were white. Because if you were black, you couldn't do any of those things. You weren't welcome at Fitzgerald's. You couldn't ride the Ferris wheel. You could go there on the streetcar, but once you got there, you had to work there, or you had to be playing an instrument for one of the cabarets or one of the bars. So Buddy Bolden occasionally played in the West End. All the musicians at one time or another played a club in the West End. But among those who played in the West End was Joe King Oliver. And King Oliver was called King Oliver because back then they used to have battles of bands and battles of players. And he beat Freddie Kapar in one famous battle of the cornet players. And so he became King Oliver. And he was so accustomed to playing there, knew it so well, that he wrote a composition based upon the West End amusement park restaurant complex that's still there in New Orleans, and he called it West End Blues. So maybe, since we're not quite to Armstrong's version, now would be a good time to play something about what King Oliver's version sounded like. Now, King Oliver just wrote the instrumentation. He didn't write the lyrics. The lyrics would be added about 10 years later. But this is the melody, which we're about to hear with Louis Armstrong. So this is a version by Ethel Waters from 1928. This is West End Blues, and I just play a couple measures of it. It's good.
I'm blue today. I've got a mean, evil feeling, and I'm full of tears.
Yeah. So that's Ethel Waters' version of Western Blues. So that's the melody that King Oliver came up with. And now and then, his band would play it around New Orleans, and later on, very crucially, in Chicago. So by this time, now it's the late teens, 1916, 1917 or so. And in fact, it was about that time, 1917, that King Oliver made the decision to leave New Orleans and start playing up in Chicago. And he was playing in Chicago, next slide, with a really, really good outfit called, as we'll see, the Creole Jazz Band. But the reason I say that was an important decision to leave New Orleans and play in Chicago was that it really paralleled what was going on at the same time throughout the South. And we're about to talk about the Great Migration, which played such an important role in popularizing blues and jazz music all across the country. But there he is, it's 1917 by now, and King Oliver was up in Chicago with the Creole Jazz Band. And that might have been the end of our story, except King Oliver was beginning to suffer from a tradition called pyorrhea, which is a gum disease that, among other causes, may be too much very, very hot trumpet playing. And that meant that Oliver needed somebody to back him up on the cornet. He needed a second player who was as not as good, he thought, as he was, but at least pretty good. And so, because it was because of late teens, he began to think of Louis Armstrong. And eventually, the call came to New Orleans for Armstrong to leave New Orleans and go up to join him at a pay of $52 a week in Chicago. And by the time the call officially came, Armstrong was 21 years old. And he had made a little bit of money here and there around New Orleans. He was beginning to acquire a reputation, just enough for King Oliver to choose him to join the Creole Jazz Band. So the big day came in the middle of the summer of 1922. And it was the middle of the summer when Armstrong left New Orleans to go to Chicago to join King Oliver. His mother assumed that Chicago had to be cold all the time. So even though it was really hot in the summer, she packed long johns in his little suitcase before she sent him off. But she also knew that in the Illinois Central, there was no way you could be black and sit in a dining car. So where was he going to eat on the Illinois Central on the way to Chicago? So she packed him a trout loaf sandwich, gave him what little money she had, and wished him good luck. So when he left New Orleans, it's 1922, in fact, a hallowed day in jazz history, August 10th, 1922, when Louis Armstrong left New Orleans, he only had one person to say goodbye, and that was his mother at the station. He wouldn't come back to New Orleans for another 9 years, but when he came back to New Orleans, he had 8 bands greeting him, lining Canal Street, and vast crowds of people there to say hello. Everything was about to change for him in the country. So up the Illinois Central he goes. It's August of 1922, and he arrived the next night just in time to catch King Oliver's set at the Lincoln Gardens on the south side of Chicago. And when the set was over, it was late at night, Oliver shook hands with Louis Armstrong, said, I've got a place for you to live. It was a room in a boarding house nearby in the Bronzeville section of Chicago, which was the African-American neighborhood at the time. And at that boarding house, at that room, for the first time in his life, Louis Armstrong would have a private bathroom. And it's now August 11th, 1922. So this is Bronzeville. The south side of Chicago during the great jazz explosion of the early 1920s. The Lincoln Gardens, where King Oliver and Armstrong were going to play with the Creole Jazz Band, was the corner of 31st and College Grove towards Lake Michigan from State Street. But the heart of Bronzeville was State Street, which bisects it north to south. And it began the African-American neighborhood, really, with 25th Street or so to the north and went down all the way to the 60s. And it was a place, especially in the 20s on State Street, that was so lined with clubs and had so many places where musicians would play that it was said that you could take a cornet and hold it up like that and it would begin playing all by itself. And those were the famous blocks called The Stroll, famous in jazz history as The Stroll. And that is where Armstrong now would make his home. He had now found himself in what would, for the next decade, be the jazz capital of America until New York took it over towards the beginning of the 1930s. But as I said before, what made it all possible was the great migration of Southern African Americans into the cities of the North. And it had started just 6 years before Armstrong got to Bronzeville. It had started in 1916 with a specific group of sharecropping families in Selma, Alabama, who decided to leave Alabama and make their fortunes to the North. And the reason they could do it then was it was during World War I, immigration had largely been cut off from Europe, and that meant there was a high demand for labor in the North. And if you were a sharecropper or a migrant farm worker in the South, if segregation kept you from any meaningful chance in life, this at least would afford you maybe the chance that you had never had before. Now, we should always remember that these migrants from the South, African-American migrants, were going from positions of oppression and tyranny into a state of affairs where at least they might have a chance, at least they could vote. At the very least, they were going to be able to vote up there. And I like to think of it in the nature of refugees, refugees from a place of tyranny to a place of relative, at least, freedom. They were, you might not often think of them as asylum seekers. That's how bad it was in the South. And it would change everything, because in 1910, before all this began, 90% of all African Americans lived in the South. By 1960, it'll be about 50-50, about 50%. It was one of the great internal migrations in the history of North America. Now, the North was not paradise by any means. So this is Bronzeville, the south side of Chicago. 85% of Chicago was off limits if you were black. Restricted covenants meant that you couldn't live there unless you were white. But you could live there, and 300,000 largely Southern African Americans were jammed into Bronzeville by the end of the 1920s. One indicator to me, and this is always interesting, of the vast significance of this movement of black people from the South to the North wasn't just the literary flowering that made possible. Wright, for example, in Hurston, for example, who eventually settled in Harlem. But it was also the second generation, their children, and what they made of their lives because of this chance that their parents would give them by migrating South to North. So just as the first generation immigrants from other parts of the world would give their children a chance in America that they were never going to have back in the old country, the same would be true of African Americans and their children. So these are some of the children of those who moved North. If we were to do justice to this, it would take about five lectures, but here's just a few names. James Earl Jones, Malcolm X, whose family settled in Detroit. Next slide, I think. Jackie Robinson. Next slide. We're good. I think next slide. I think that's where out of order here. Yeah, there it is. Jacob Lawrence, one of the great painters of the 20th century, whose paintings, The Great Migration Series, actually you can see now at the Peabody Essex Museum in Salem. Jesse Owens, Toni Morrison. Toni Morrison's mother was from, her father was from Georgia. And then the previous slide, who I meant to show, this guy, a kid born into a sharecropping family in Calvert, Texas, who arrived in Los Angeles with his mother and father and four siblings when he was 7 years old, who became the mayor of Los Angeles, Tom Bradley. What would his life have been if his family had to stay in Texas? But they moved, and he could be Tom Bradley, the mayor of Los Angeles. And also a toddler who moved with her mother from Newport News, Virginia, to Yonkers at about the time Armstrong left New Orleans to go to Chicago. And she began singing for change on the streets of Harlem as a teenager and ended up singing for Chick Webb at the Apollo Ballroom. And now we go two slides in the future. And that, of course, was Ella Fitzgerald. There she was. And it was said of Ella Fitzgerald that she was so good she could sing the New York City phone book and make it sound lyrical. Imagine the vast quantity of this talent that would have been wasted in the segregated South, where they wouldn't have had any meaningful chance. Not to mention Ray Charles, who Frank Sinatra called the only true genius in popular music. And then the next slide, a different kind of genius. There's Berry Gordy, whose family was from Washington County, Georgia, but moved to Detroit in 1922, same year Louis Armstrong showed up the Lincoln Gardens on the South Side. And eventually Gordy would found Motown Records, which conquered the world 40 years later. And part of that world was the Beatles in Liverpool. And the Beatles loved Motown. And Ringo Starr always said that the one kind of music all four Beatles liked equally was Motown. They all had slightly different tastes, but they all loved Motown equally. And the Beatles recorded Please Please Me, Motown song. They recorded Money, Motown song. And they recorded a song by Smokey Robinson, whose family was from Memphis, Tennessee, You Really Got a Hold on Me, a song John Lennon really liked. And John Lennon in the Beatles cover of Smokey Robinson's You Really Got a Hold on Me was so good that Diana Ross and the Supremes did a cover of their cover of Smokey Robinson. So now we go to the next slide. So here's the magic that was now happening. The Supremes did a cover of, next slide. The Beatles cover of, next slide. Smokey Robinson's composition, You Really Got a Hold on Me. And eventually, one of the people listening to that would be young Stevie Wonder, another person whose family came from the South. His mother was from Eufaula, Alabama, next cover. And Stevie Wonder would do a cover of the Beatles' We Can Work It Out, which many think is the greatest Beatles cover of all time. And that is what music in America should be about, right there, I think. And none of it would have been possible without the Great Migration. And now, finally, we're about to get to the song. Not quite, but almost. Now, the song for today, as I said, was written by King Oliver at some point in the 1920s. And as you heard when Ethel Waters did her version of it, it's not nearly as fast as Tiger Rag. Oliver's band, with Louis Armstrong now in it, playing second cornet, they could play fast, they could play frenetic, just like the original Dixieland Jazz Band did. But they really appreciated melody and a relaxed kind of swing. At a time, a moderate tempo that proved to be second nature to Armstrong. All his life, he could play as fast as anybody, but all his life, probably his greatest artistic moments came when he slowed things down and he played things lyrically and with his own characteristic kind of style. Now, the Creole Jazz Band, led by King Oliver, would play to packed houses at Lincoln Gardens, which was a black and tan, which meant that there could be white and black audiences as they were up there on the stage. And everybody went there. Hoagy Carmichael went there every chance he got. Take some gin, a little bit of marijuana, as we'll hear in a second, and he'd go down to the Lincoln Gardens, and he would say that he was filled with despair when he'd hear King Oliver and Armstrong play. And the despair came from the fact that not everybody in the world was listening to this. It actually made him feel unhappy that this was only in Chicago that anybody was hearing this. Benny Goodman would go. Benny Goodman was still in short pants. It's just a kid, and he'd get in there somehow, and he'd listen to King Oliver and Louis Armstrong. Nobody came away the same after hearing that band. And it might have gone on for a long time, because Armstrong really idolized King Oliver. And King Oliver was a tough guy. King Oliver kept a gun in his cornet case, specially designed case. This guy was tough, but he was really good and really generous to people just coming up, which is how Armstrong got his big break. And he felt that he owed a lot to King Oliver. Joe King Oliver might never have left, except next slide. He was just so good that his soon-to-be wife insisted that he take another career move. So this is King Oliver's Creole Jazz Band. And this is Armstrong. He's kind of fooling around on a slide instrument, but that's Armstrong. And that's King Oliver up there. And this is the woman who would be Armstrong's second wife. So that's Lil Hardin. Lil Hardin believed, and she was right, of course, that Armstrong was so good, he shouldn't really be second to anybody. And he was always going to be second to King Oliver if he stayed in that band. Now, she knew what she was talking about because she had some very good formal training in music. She had grown up in a middle-class environment in Memphis. She went to Fisk University for a while in Nashville. And then she moved with her family to Chicago. And she got her break playing a bit with King Oliver's band. She was billed as the Hot Miss Lil at the time, the Hot Miss Lil. She didn't think much of Armstrong when she first met him. She thought he was too fat, kind of funny hair. But she heard him play, and I think that probably was it for her. They fell in love, they got married, and she began pushing him to do more with his career. She finally began prodding him, you need to leave Chicago, you'll always be in Oliver's shadow here, and go to New York. The first offer you get, you should go to New York. And finally, Armstrong decided to do it, and one reason seems to have been that Oliver was caught skimming a few dollars here and there off the salaries of the band members. And so there was a bit of a dispute, and maybe that helped Armstrong finally take Hardin's advice. And so now it was off to New York in the 1923 or 24, to play for Fletcher Henderson at the Roseland Ballroom on 51st Street, where on his very first day with Fletcher Henderson's band, having been hired, they were rehearsing, and I think Armstrong was probably a little bit nervous, because during the rehearsal, he continued to play extremely loud, even though the music said PP, pianissimo, PP. So Henderson stopped the group, and he pointed to Armstrong, said, why are you playing so loud? It's PP, pianissimo. And Armstrong said, PP, I thought that was pound plenty, pound plenty. Now, he knew good and well PP didn't mean pound plenty. I think he was just nervous and he missed it. But that broke everybody up. And so instead of sending him back home to Chicago, he stayed with the band and proved to be a great success. And here, I think, is one of the distinguishing things about Armstrong. Next slide. This is another picture of Lil Hardin, and she'll come back in the story in a second. One of the things about Armstrong, very important to remember, was as a musician, he was serious to the utmost. He was a showman. He liked to clown around on stage. But his musicianship was something he took with extraordinary seriousness. He could never understand musicians who would waste time between sets playing poker or something when they could be talking about music or talking to other musicians at wherever they were playing about what they were doing and what they were thinking. So when they were playing the Roseland with Fletcher Henderson, another band playing there featured Red Nichols on the cornet, a famous cornet player from Utah, little redheaded Red Nichols. And Armstrong and Red Nichols, during any break they got, would go down to the basement and Armstrong would play something about his ideas and Nichols would play something that he was thinking of. They never just sat around. And he never understood anybody who wouldn't practice and practice and practice and practice all they could to make the best of them. To me, the figure that comes in mind when I think of Armstrong and his work ethic is Larry Bird. Because if you know basketball, Larry Bird in Indiana always felt sorry for other members of the team who were not practicing three-point shots all the time. Why wouldn't you do that? And that's the way Louis Armstrong felt about it. He could never understand musicians who squandered their talents with heavy drinking. He did not approve of heavy drinking. And if you were in his band, you were drinking too much, he would call you on it. One of the sorrows of his life was when Bix Beiderbecke died of heavy drinking. Armstrong admired Beiderbecke. And he believed that that was the road to ruin. Why would you do that when you could be practicing, when you could be talking about music? His only vice, if you want to call it that, was marijuana. Armstrong loved marijuana, and he smoked marijuana. They used to call it muggles back then, pretty much every day. But he felt that relaxed him and helped him concentrate. But he felt alcohol would make you lazy. You couldn't get up on time. You wouldn't be good at rehearsals, and it's better avoided. Now, another distinguishing feature about him was despite all the trouble in his life, despite his poverty-stricken background, and all the difficulties he had coming up, he was always cheerful by nature. And he insisted on having a lot of that optimism reflected in his music. He had no trouble at all following King Oliver's advice to him. One time, Joe King Oliver pulled Armstrong aside, and he said, "It's the audience that should cry, not you. Whatever trouble you're in, you have to learn never to wear it on your face." Now, he found it easy to incorporate humor and cheerfulness in his music. He didn't like to dwell on the miseries of life. He wanted to express the happiness of life. And that just was part of his temperament. And he kept that throughout his career until he died in the early 1970s. But of course, the other thing about him was he was prodigiously talented on the cornet. And by the middle of the 1920s, more and more, Fletcher Henderson was allowing him to play solos, both live and on their records. And that was a major departure because jazz, in the early days of jazz, had always been an ensemble art. You play together with a characteristic sound of the ensemble. And maybe the trumpet player would take the lead on the melody, but the clarinetist and the trombone would be improvising all around the melody. So it wasn't as you were really playing a solo. You were playing lead, but not really a solo on most of these compositions. But Armstrong, with Henderson's permission, began to play 16-measure solos when it was just him and maybe percussion. He'd do that on record, he'd do that live. And those who saw it live describe it as electric, like nothing they'd ever heard from the cornet. And it was those short solos that really marked the beginning of the soloist tradition in jazz, about to be the virtuoso tradition in jazz. So that jazz wouldn't just be an ensemble art form. It'd be a solo art form, as it specifically would be, especially later in the 20th century. And he was so good and so popular that Lil Hardin more and more began to persuade him, you gotta leave Fletcher Henderson in New York and you gotta lead your own group. That's the next step. And if he couldn't do that in New York, he'd have to go back in Chicago to do that. And so finally, She delivered an ultimatum, Lil Hardin did. She went to her husband, Louis Armstrong, and she said, it's either Fletcher Henderson or me. Maybe Armstrong was still trying to think about it, but the thing that really made him mad was that he wanted to sing. He's like Ted Williams. Ted Williams, like one of the greatest flyers, one of the greatest hitters, one of the greatest fishermen of all time. Too much talent in one person. Louis Armstrong, maybe the greatest trumpet player of all time, also one of the greatest singers of all time. But he couldn't show his singing with Fletcher. Fletcher Henderson would not let him sing. So the only way he was going to get to sing was to lead his own group. And so finally, he decided, by the time it was early 1926, to leave New York and finally go to Chicago. And by the time he was 27 years old, he was playing at the Dreamland Cafe on the Stroll. The Dreamland Cafe was a black and tan, open to whites and blacks, had a ballroom capable of holding 800 people at the Dreamland. And a major plus in the summer, it had 18 powerful electric fans. And it was at the Dreamland that he was billed as the world's greatest cornet player. Ready to begin recording with a group he put together, the original Hot Fives, featuring Lil Hardin, his wife, on the piano, along with the great Kid Ory on the trombone. Freed at last to sing for the first time, Armstrong led the Hot Five in its famous recording for OK Records of Heebie Jeebies. And according to the story he told, one of the most famous stories in jazz, he was singing the first verse of Heebie Jeebies, Everything's Fine, during the recording. And then, right before the second verse, what happens is he drops his notes with the lyrics, which means he's got to improvise different sounds to the melody when his turn came up to sing again. And what he was doing was what he and a bunch of other New Orleans singers used to do. He didn't invent this, but he put it on record, scat singing, of course. And after scat singing appeared on Heebie-Jeebies, that side sold 40,000 copies. And now Armstrong was on his way as a recording artist. And it was a later version of the Hot Five in 1928. This one featuring Fred Robinson on the trombone. And then next slide, the great Earl Hines on the piano. There he is. That would give us finally Armstrong's version of West End Blues, which we're about to hear, called by jazz commentator Brian Denton, quote, the greatest sound recording of the entire 20th century. So it was going to be Earl Hines, as you saw, on piano. And then this next guy, wanted to point him out. Next slide. That's Zuddy Singleton on the drummer. Zuddy is just a Creole expression for cute, but he was on the drums. And then others that we'll talk about in a second. So before we get there, now we go to the next slide. One thing that to me helps explain what's so great about West End Blues is that to me, this piece of music combines what all great art combines, and that is an extremely strong sense of the individual and the particular with an extremely strong sense of the universal. So you have some things about West End Blues that could only have happened then from Louis Armstrong, and other aspects of it that all persons who ever lived could understand. And I compare it with a Hassam painting that everybody in Boston loves. This is a Boston Common at twilight. And one thing about this is it's extremely particular. And all Bostonians know what we're looking at. So that's Tremont Street there. Park Street's kind of in back of us, but Tremont Street goes like that, and there's Boylston, and the sun is setting over there to the west, and we know it's probably about 4:45 in the afternoon, maybe in late December, early January, something like that. Can only be one time, one place, and this is Boston, it's the Common, and anybody can recognize that. So it's a beautiful depiction of the particular, but it's also a beautiful depiction of the universal. Because everybody can identify with her. We all know that's a mother, and she's got her two children, and you can see in her posture that she kind of needs to be somewhere. Maybe she's got dinner to direct, but she doesn't want to go yet because her kids are having fun feeding the birds. And everybody knows that emotion when you've got someplace to be, and you know you got to be there, but you want your kids to have a little bit of extra fun time. So that's the universal part of it. And it's right there in the same painting, the particular in the universal. And West End Blues is like that to me. The particular is obvious. It could only have been recorded by Louis Armstrong. The cadenza could only, literally only, have been played by Louis Armstrong. It'd be 15 years before any trumpet player was able to do that cadenza. It'd be 15 years. So nobody could have done it but Louis Armstrong. It could not have been possible without the Chicago scene that he was a part of it, a scene that was increasingly favoring good, virtuistic solo artists. But it was also, as we'll hear, universal. It expresses a fundamentally and universal sense of the bittersweetness of life. The cheer always tinged with a little bit of sadness that life is not just beautiful, but it's also something we'll all eventually have to leave. And there's nothing more universal than that. So you put it all together, and you get West End Blues, Louis Armstrong's version. So maybe as a way to introduce it, this song, this tune, this piece of music tells us or shows us what happens when you put all these things together. On June 28th, 1928, the blues of the Mississippi Valley, at a moderate swing tempo, brushing up against Herbert Clark in the cadenza tradition on the virtuoso cornet, against the background of a segregated New Orleans pleasure ground, the West End, which in itself has a bit of sense of joy and loss about it at the same time. Through the mind of the consummate master of the trumpet, Louis Armstrong, and the other virtuosos he was playing with, especially the great Earl Hines. You put all that together and you get this. But keep in mind that when the Hot Five recorded this, West End Blues, it's very likely that Armstrong had not had any sleep that morning. They played a gig the previous night, it went late, and what he often did before an OK Studios recording session is he just would walk around for a while and then he'd go into the studio. He didn't actually go to sleep. So it's very likely he'd been up more than 24 hours when he did this. And it's also important to keep in mind that what you're about to hear is not the first take. They did a few takes of West End Blues. And during one of the takes, Singleton, the drummer, actually let his cymbals fall on the floor, made a huge racket, so they couldn't use that. But this is the one that stuck. And the last thing to keep in mind, now we go to the next slide, is by now Armstrong had indeed switched from the cornet to the trumpet. And that's the cornet, older version of cornet when they had different kinds of bells, but you can see it's much more compact. And then we all know what a trumpet looks like. The next slide is the trumpet. And we think the reason he switched to the trumpet was that it made a more satisfying, piercing sound in the higher registers. And Louis Armstrong loved to be in the higher registers. And so he eventually switched to trumpet. And by the time he was with the Hot Fives, that's mostly what he was playing. I think to tell the difference between a cornet and a trumpet, you kind of have to be an expert on cornets and trumpets. But Armstrong always said that to him, at least, was the difference. So we begin, before we get to the melody, which we'll end with, but we begin with a famous cadenza called by jazz critic Murray Horowitz the most important 15 seconds in all American music. And not just because it appears to be absolutely impossible to play, but also because it is the point where jazz really became a soloist virtuoso medium of music. And this is what would give rise to Dizzy Gillespie and Charlie Parker in the great tradition, which goes on today, of jazz virtuosos. It's rapid-paced hot jazz in that cadenza. But it is in the form of a cadenza, which, as Armstrong knew, was the signature style of Herbert Clark. So after several measures of brilliance, the cadenza culminates in a high C, and not only a high C, as you'll hear, but a high C played soft, which is really hard to do. But Armstrong loved to reach high Cs, so much so that as time went on, his lips suffered terribly from all those high notes, building up scar tissue that Armstrong would occasionally try to remove with a razor blade just so he could play. Now, and eventually what can happen if that goes on is a muscle called the obiscularis orbis ruptures, requiring medical attention. And that's what happened with Armstrong, and they call it Satchmo syndrome because of that. When the cadenza's over, Armstrong's lead is you can now hear on the melody. So the cadenza gives way to the melody of West End Blues, moderate swing style, which I think is where Armstrong was at his best, followed by a little duet between Armstrong and the clarinetist, Jimmy Strong. Armstrong singing a little bit of kind of modified moderate scat. And Strong, the clarinetist, is playing in the low registers of a clarinet, as you'll hear, in a range known as a chalumeau. Now, all of this would have been enough for a classic. That would have been it. But what happens next is Earl Hines decides to come in. Earl Hines, a Pittsburgh native that Count Basie once called the greatest jazz piano player in the world, as influential on the jazz piano as Louis Armstrong was on the trumpet, was Hines. So what a wealth of riches. We got Armstrong, and then a minute and a half later, we have Earl Hines on the piano. Unbelievable. Nothing can top that, except Armstrong proceeds to top it, if you want to put it that way, with another solo marked by a high note, I think it's B flat, sustained for four measures, without a breath in the high note, a sound of pure triumph and pure joy, which will remind you of why Bing Crosby said that Louis Armstrong was the beginning and the end of American music. And then finally, all that resolves miraculously in a little bit of cymbal playing by Zutty Singleton. And it comes as close to me of being at the most perfect 3.5 minutes in American music. Okay. This has happened to me, so don't worry. So now I think it's time to hear it. So with all that as an introduction, we will now do what always makes me uncomfortable, which is for me not to talk. And then, oh, is it too loud? It's impossible. His high C. And that's a Freddie Robinson on the trombone. West End Blues, you stop that. And I was one of those supreme moments. Oh, no, not that.
Morally complex questions.
That's interesting, but maybe not. But so the, anybody can see that that's genius. So, and now jazz and American music in general, but especially this music, could begin to take its place as one of the great musical art forms in the world, in history, something like that. It's serious, it's beautiful, it's accessible, and nobody could deny that the sheer talent involved. And now it will be music that will help sweep the world. And to me, that's recording session at OK Records, one of the supreme moments of 20th century American history. I'd put it along with the Apollo 8 circling the moon as things that make me proud to be an American. It's that in Apollo 8. So they did a lot of other recordings as well, but often a lot of people think of that as the best. I suppose that's a matter of argument, but a lot of people think so. When the record came out, Armstrong and Hines hadn't really listened to it in a long time because they did the recording session, then they went on to something else. But then the record came out, and they got a copy of it, and they began playing it, and they were astonished about how good it was. Okay? Maybe they'd been thinking about other things, and they played it over and over and over again. Surprised how good it really was. And then Billie Holiday heard it, and she also played it over and over and over again, and she later said that sometimes she began to cry, and sometimes she began laughing uproariously. What other indication of a great piece of art than that? She said she was crying up a storm at one point. And then she was so damn happy, as she put it, so damn happy. What a great piece of music is supposed to do. In the West End Blues, in the other recordings of the Hot Five, and later the Hot Seven, do give us, I think, the tradition, as I said, of jazz as a virtuoso soloist art. It would not primarily be a composer's art, but it would be an art in which, as Terry Teachout writes, the brilliant, charismatic performer would sweep the country and the world. Be great composers in jazz, like Duke Ellington and Billy Strayhorn, but it was also going to be as much of a virtuoso art as anything else. And Artie Shaw heard those records and became obsessed with the idea that he had to do this too. And many musicians would say the same thing. The records alone did not make Armstrong the star he would become, at least not those recording sessions, but they helped shape the character of music from then to the present day. American music, that can proudly stand on its own two feet and stand comparison with any music that's ever been devised. And if you listen to that, you can see how that can be. So I thought maybe, now that we've heard West End Blues, now would be a good time to take a break. And I can maybe say a few more words about Armstrong, if you want, when we come back. So thank you. Thank you. Your time to share maybe a comment about West End Blues or what jazz means to you in general. I did want to point out that Armstrong has a distinction of having hit records in five different decades, which is not easy to do, starting with the 20s and going on to the 60s. And he's the answer to the famous trivia question, what artist knocked the Beatles off the number one position after I Want to Hold Your Hand came out? And that was Louis Armstrong with Hello Dolly. So he was still relevant well into the 60s. Not all jazz musicians maybe followed him with the admiration of the early days by the 50s and 60s, but there are people who think he continued to be as great an artist to the very end as he always was. He was just doing his own thing, even though his own thing might not have been as popular as it used to be. But he also has the distinction of being one of the early major American musicians to be arrested on a criminal charge related to drugs. He was arrested in California for using marijuana outside, just kind of in the alley, outside during a break in a performance, which is not unusual for him. But somebody told on him, the police kind of were upset about it. They didn't really want to arrest him, but they did. And he served 9 days in jail before the judge let him go. Somebody talked to the judge, and then he didn't have to serve a 30-day sentence. But he began with marijuana at a time when it was legal in most places. And he always just thought of it that way. It's nothing that was doing anybody any harm. But to him, although maybe not to everybody, it proved something that he didn't really have a problem with. So I was wondering if anybody had a question or especially a comment, those of you who know more about this than I do, about what makes this significant.
I have a question.
Okay.
What happened to his second wife and the other?
Oh, that's a good question. All sorts of stories about that. A lot of the information I have about Louis Armstrong came from the fine Terry Teachout biography, which was probably here in Bedford at the library. But they had falling outs based upon mutual accusations of infidelity with Lil Hardin. And that marriage broke down. And then while that marriage was going on, Armstrong had begun seeing another woman, and he married her. And that marriage broke down, I think, for similar reasons. And that led to the last marriage, which was with Lucille. And that marriage lasted until Louis Armstrong died. They had that house in Queens where they lived. And Lucille was a bit younger than Louis Armstrong, but she, I think, was the personality that really matched his own. I don't think they ever had a problem once they got married. I think they married in the 40s. So for the last 30 odd years of his life, 25 to 30 years, he was married to Lucille.
How old was he?
He was 71 or 70 when he died. Yeah. Where's the house in Queens? It's a historic landmark, so you can find it.
Just near LaGuardia Airport.
Okay. So that house has been maintained. Unfortunately, what has happened via urban renewal is that a lot of what had been Black Storyville is gone. It's big boxy buildings and parking lots. And that's true of Bronzeville, too. So a lot of the Stroll, where the old clubs were, is it Illinois Tech or something like that? But it's a major campus.
Illinois Institute of Technology.
Very good. That's it. That's what it is, Illinois Institute of Technology. Excellent. Glad you're here. That's right. So you can see little plaques now and then about where the guys used to play, but the buildings are by and large gone, with just a few exceptions.
There's a nice statue in New Orleans of him, too.
Of Louis Armstrong, yeah. So he has two nicknames, Pops and Satchmo. They called him Pops because Louis Armstrong, like me, had a bad memory for names. So sometimes he wouldn't quite know who you were, so he'd call you Pops, 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 Pops. So they eventually called him Pops. Okay, you call us, so now you're Pops. So he was always Pops for most of his life. And then he became Satchmo. They used to call him Satchel Mouth because he had a large mouth. So part of why he was maybe so great at the trumpet. He would have just called Satchel Mouth. But he took his famous first tour of England, where he would play in, we would call them vaudeville, but they were houses with all sorts of different acts in them. And he was being interviewed by somebody, and the interviewer happened to call him Satchmo, because a British accent, Satchel Mouth, that particular British accent came out of Satchmo. And Armstrong kind of liked that. Satchmo was kind of better than Satchel Mouth, so he always became Satchmo after that. So that's a little bit of Armstrong trivia. He was such a great artist, and I don't think I'm capable of expressing how great he was. Maybe that's what all great artists are like. But maybe some of you are, so I thought I'd give you the chance.
I think he did a great job talking about the picture and the universal and the individual and then matching it up with the music.
That was that painting is very important. And that painting is very important to me.
Yes, yes.
So my wife and I met for like a second date under that painting. Yeah, she's over there, yeah. So when I take students to the MFA, I always go by there too, because I like it so much.
It's a beautiful.
Yeah. Anything else? Well, by the way, what do we talk about next week? Is it Billie Holiday or Irving Berlin? I gotta go out and look at the sign.
The fruit is the
strange fruit?
Oh,
so next week we get to talk about Irving Berlin. So next week we're going to have a lot of fun. Irving Berlin, God Bless America. And we're going to go to the Lower East Side, long way from New Orleans, a whole different tradition. But traditions have really influenced each other, which is the way it should be. So we'll be talking about the great Tin Pan Alley tradition and the immigrant from Eastern Europe tradition with Irving Berlin. So that's really going to be a lot of fun. So I hope to see you all next week. Go ahead. Yes, go ahead. Yeah,
Wilkerson.
Yeah, it's from a line. Is it Richard Wright who made that line? But the book is written by somebody else, right?
Isabel Wilkerson.
Oh, right.
Yes. She's a professor at Boston University.
That's right, the warmth of a very famous quote.
And follow up with the families that most of several generations have changed the whole outlook.
And that's right. And it's worth pointing out that there's now a reverse Great Migration. And they're from African Americans who grew up in the North, now going to places like Atlanta and Birmingham again, Houston. They're not going into the rural areas where their ancestors often grew up. They're going into the southern cities. And they're making those cities a bit more progressive than they used to be. And maybe over time, they'll change the election demographics of the South. We'll have to see. But that's going on right now. Yeah. So go ahead, yes. Yes. That's good. $52, you can't, yeah, that's fine. That's really good, $52 a week. Probably four times what you can make as a laborer, for example. So, yeah, mm-hmm. Good pay. So, and he was, by the time he really began to hit it big with a hot seven, and the records became hit records. In the early 30s, he had genuine hit records. He's one of the most popular recording artists in America by then. He was making $1,000 per record, per side. First by OK Records, later by the others.
Mm-hmm.
So he was doing very well. And he was careful with his money. He didn't waste it. He had trouble sometimes with his managers who might waste money that were entrusted to them, but he himself didn't waste it. Now go ahead.
You talked about his doing surgery on his lip. Did his lip finally give out?
It became weaker over time. I wouldn't say it gave out necessarily. I don't think it really gave up because I think he just kept playing to the end. But it was never going to be the same again. There's no way it could be. That's right. And?
What did he do during the war?
During the war, he was, as far as his popularity goes, kind of in a trough. But he played gigs, largely in New York, I think. And he made recordings, but I don't have any specific anecdotes in mind about the war. Some of you might. I don't know if he traveled very much and played for the troops. He would do that later. He would do that in the 50s and 60s, but I'm not sure he did that much during the war.
It was interesting, that little five-piece span. He was kneeling on the floor. Another man was on top of the piano with his legs all spread out.
Yeah, well, probably a posed photo, but you would have to be. That's right. Yeah, that was the Creole Jazz Band, or King Oliver's outfit. There's also a bunch of pictures of the Hot Fives that you can see online. But sometimes it's difficult because they had different lineups, and I didn't want to risk having the wrong lineup for the West End Blues recording, so I didn't show a picture of them. Yes, go ahead. Well, I don't think that's true. I think he was sometimes discouraged by the slow pace of integration. He would get angry at individuals, like all of us do, especially his managers sometimes. But he was known to have been extremely discouraged with President Eisenhower, who he thought moved too slowly in Little Rock to try to make sure the students at the high school were safe, at Central High School. So there are moments in his interviews when he seems angry, and there are moments in his diary. But it's certainly not true that but just as a blanket proposition, he hated white people. That I don't think he was capable of much hatred at all. So go ahead.
In fact, he'd be called an Uncle Tom by some of the blacks who were more revolutionary. So he had a tough line to walk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a very, very tough line to walk. He always tried to be true to his own sense of what a great artist would be. He always felt that he was an entertainer. He liked making people laugh. That's just what he felt entertainers ought to do. And I think sometimes that came across the wrong way. But he was always well-intentioned, and he certainly always supported integration, however he might. There's no doubt about that, both with his money and with his time. So, go ahead, yes.
Did he ever have any children?
Did he? Yes, but I can't remember how many or who. I guess I should have looked at that biography more thoroughly. But did he?
He had one son.
One son, okay, very good. Yeah, but.
I forget the name, but I was looking it up during the break.
Okay, good, well, I'm glad. Well, you've been very helpful.
80-something.
Oh, yes.
Jason,
maybe. Okay, Jason? Okay.
But not the dancer.
No. All right, so yeah, that's kind of what I recalled, but I couldn't remember how many children. Good, so one son. Anyway, musically, we have to go, I guess, in a different direction. Although, as I said, a direction that would unify with the greater jazz direction eventually. And that's the grand tradition of American popular song, middle of the 20th century, with Irving Berlin. So we'll pick up with him when I see you next. Thank you. Thanks.